Hey everyone, I've been working with Rocket God on the LaserTag game for the Flipper Zero. One of the features he wanted to add was the ability to read a tag to increase your health or ammo level. Last month at DEF CON, Rabbit Labs gave me one of these cool RFID keychains. The Flipper Zero can program any low frequency RFID code onto it, so I've decided to use the EM4100 protocol. My RFID playlist goes into lots of detail on the EM4100, but basically it's 5 bytes of user-defined data. In this video, we'll take a look at a library I wrote for reading low-frequency RFID tags on the Flipper Zero. We'll do a quick debugging session, and we'll talk about shared bus resources on the Flipper Zero. And good news, the latest version in the App Store now supports RFID for ammo. Let's get started. I'm going to assume you've written a Flipper Zero application before. If you haven't, I encourage you to check out my code playlist, in particular setting up your environment and writing a code to blink an LED. If you've never debugged an application, I recommend watching the debugging furry of cert failures video. In Visual Studio Code, I've created a test project called LFRFID demo. Inside of that project, we have the lfrfid_reader.c file. I wrote this file to help abstract out how we communicate with the RFID library. I'll probably go into the details of how to create this file in a future video. Switching over to the header file, lfrfid_reader.h, we can see the functions that are exposed by that C file. Hopefully, these function names feel familiar. The first one we have is alloc, and this allocates our LFRFID reader, which we'll pass to the other functions. Next, we have setTagCallback. This allows you to specify a callback function and a context to pass to that function. Whenever a tag is detected that matches that requested protocol, it'll call your callback function, passing it that context and the information about the tag. The start function will start listening for tags. When a tag is detected, it'll log the name of that tag. And if the tag matches the protocol that you've requested, it'll invoke your callback. The stop function stops listening for tags. The free function will release all the resources that were allocated when you called alloc. The last thing I wanted to look at on this page is that callback function signature. That signature is defined on line 20. The first parameter is the data from the tag. The second parameter is the length of data in bytes. And the third parameter is the context to the callback. This context will match the object we passed in setTagCallback. And our callback function returns a void. Now that we know what all the functions do, let's take a look at a demo application that uses these functions. I've opened app.c, which is a little console application I wrote. We'll start by looking at the entry point of this application, and then afterwards we'll look at the callback. The first step is to allocate our LFRFID reader using LFRFID reader alloc. Next, we call setTagCallback. We pass in that reader object that we just allocated. For the requested protocol, we're passing EM4100 since that's the tags we're using in our game. You could also pass H10301 or a different protocol name. For our callback, we're passing tagCallback, which is the name of our callback function. And then we're passing null for the context since our callback doesn't need any context. Typically, you would pass an app object or some other state, or maybe your event queue. Now that our callback's all configured, we call LFRFID reader start. This starts scanning for tags, and whenever a tag is detected that matches the EM4100, it will call our callback function. Next, we sleep for 45 seconds. But while we're sleeping, it's still scanning for tags and calling our callback. Most Flipper applications do UI instead, and we kind of do this reading until the back button was pressed. Next, we call LFRFID reader stop. At this point, we should no longer be able to scan tags, and our callback should no longer be getting invoked. We sleep for 5 more seconds so we can test that the tags are not getting read. And then finally, we call LFRFID reader free to free the resources. So hopefully nothing too surprising there. Let's go ahead and take a look at what that callback does when it detects an EM4100 tag. We say unused context since we're not using that parameter. Again, in your application, you may want to cast that context into an app object or event queue or whatever. Next, we log that a tag was detected and the number of bytes of data. An EM4100 always has 5 bytes of data, so we make sure that that length is 5. Then we log those 5 bytes of data, index 0 through 4. And for the laser tag game, I decided that the first byte will be 13 and the second byte will be 37. So if the tags do not match that, then it's not a tag for the laser tag game. If the tag's not for the game, we log a warning and then we return. And then if we didn't log a warning, we'll go ahead and do whatever code we need to process that tag. Now it's time to run the application and see what happens. In a web browser, I opened lab.flipper.net/CLI and connected it to my Flipper Zero. I'll go ahead and start the log debug command. And then on the Flipper, I'll run the test application. You can see it's scanning for tags. I'll put it on the first tag, and there it is, a H10301 tag. If you wanted your callback to get invoked when you scan this tag, you'd have to pass the text, quote, H10301 to set tag callback. Now we'll scan that second tag. And this tag is an EM4100. In our callback, you can see we're printing tag detected with length 5. And then we're printing those 5 bytes of data. But the first 2 bytes are not 1337, so we're printing tag is not for game. We'll go ahead and scan that third tag. There it is. This tag is also an EM4100. Our callback was invoked and printed length 5. And that tag starts with 1337, so the message tag is not for game is not displayed. I probably should have added another information message that said that the tag was for the game. At this point, we can see that the library is working as expected, and now it's ready to be added to the laser tag game. I updated laser tag with that alloc set tag and start. Now we're running the laser tag game with my updates, and we crashed with a furry check failed error. For debugging asserts, I recommend you go to terminal and then run task and then choose debug flash USB with resources. This will make sure that the code running on your computer matches the code that's running inside of your Flipper. Make sure your Flipper is plugged in and that QFlipper is not open and that lab.flipper.net or serial connection is not open either. After a few minutes, your Flipper Zero will be running your custom firmware. Once you've updated the firmware, go into Settings and then go into System and then go into Debug and make sure it's turned to On and then go ahead and back out to the main screen. Go ahead and unplug the cable from the Flipper and plug it into your ESP32 debugger. Your debugger should be running the Blackmagic firmware. I'll go ahead and close that debug console window and also make our call stack a little bit wider. At the top of our call stack, we can see a furry crash implementation call. This can get invoked by a furry check, a furry crash, or a furry assert. Next in our call stack, we have furry hal bus enable. And most of those furry checks are making sure that something's not already enabled. And you can see our bus is furry hal bus TIM2. And this represents the second timer. Moving further up the call stack, we can see we're calling furry hal bus enable, passing that RFID capture TIM bus. And if we right click and choose go to definition, we see the RFID bus is just furry hal bus time 2. I'll click on that call stack again And then we'll go up to Explorer. And this time we'll look for the furry HAL infrared.c. In here, you can see we're calling furry HAL bus enable for infrared RX timer bus and for infrared DMA timer bus. If we right click on infrared RX timer bus and say go to definition, we can see it's also defined as furry HAL bus timer 2. So this means we can't receive infrared at the same time we're trying to receive low frequency RFID. On my Flipper Zero tutorials wiki, I created a bus resources page. And if you scroll down, I have a table that lists the different features of the Flipper Zero and which bus they use. You can use this table to determine if two features can be used at the same time. Note that this is not an exhaustive list, but it's some of the common timers that overlap. The solution I came up with was to only read RFID tags on a key up event. We pause the infrared controller, and then we start our LF RFID reader. And then in this version of the code, we wait for 3 seconds or until the ammo is updated. We stop the RFID reader, and then we resume reading infrared. So we'll go ahead and try that modified laser tag game. I'll choose Team Red. And good news, it's not crashing. You can see I'm firing the ammo. And I'm able to also shoot the other player. And when I press the up button, and now we can read a tag to increase our ammo. Now you know how to read RFID tags in your Flipper Zero application. Please like and subscribe. And if you have any questions, leave a comment below or contact me on Discord.